Hello, and welcome to the Dental Learning Center. I'm Dr. Marie Huggy. Today, we have as our special guest Dr. Hugh Greenstone. Welcome.
Thank you, Marie.
Dr. Greenstone, today we like to look at a preparation for the anterior all-ceramic crown.
Yes, Marie. The all-ceramic crown seems to be the horse in front because of its excellent aesthetics, excellent translucency, and soft tissue response. The wheel has turned and I'm excited about the future of our profession.
Well, let's verify our history and diagnosis, shall we, and get started.
Marie, I've got my breath in my fist. Let's go.
The slide illustrates the minimum reduction requirements.
You know, Marie, one disadvantage to these restorations is the necessity for greater reduction of the lingual and proximal surfaces. These restorations don't have the strength of metal, and the brittle nature of porcelain requires a shoulder margin. Porcelain tends to be an unforgiving material and can be more technique sensitive.
Right you are, Dr. Whitestone. This type of crown is indicated in areas of high aesthetic requirement, where a more conservative restoration would be inadequate. Sufficient tooth structure must exist to support the porcelain, which normally should not exceed 2 mm thickness.
And, ideally, the occlusion should be in an area supported by tooth structure. These restorations should not be used in high occlusal stress situations, on teeth that do not permit the minimum required reduction. Teeth with short clinical crowns often do not offer sufficient support for these restorations.
The preparation step sequence is very similar to that of the PFM crown.
That's right, Marie. The main difference is that the all-ceramic crown needs a minimum of 1 mm shoulder margin circumscribing the tooth.
Well, what about the shoulder margin?
For the PFM with a butt porcelain finish line, the axial line angle is 90 degrees. However, for the all-ceramic crown a curved internal axial line angle is utilized. Ideally, the cavo surface margin should be 90 degrees to provide support to the porcelain. In fact, Marie, all line angles are rounded to prevent areas of stress concentration.
The figure inset demonstrates the tip of the rounded bow used to form the finish line. Well, I believe the first step is to reduce the incisal edge.
Correct. Upon completion at smoothing and finishing, the reduction at the incisal edge is between 1.5 to 2 mm.
Hugh, how does one measure that?
One can measure the burr diameter with a caliper, but at about one-third the length of the burr from the tip, the diameter is about 1.5 mm. So, depth cuts are made by using the burr itself as a depth guide.
And what about the orientation of the burr?
Marie, the burr is oriented perpendicular to the long axis of the opposing tooth, in this case the mandibular incisor.
Well, doctor, what if the mandible is edentulous?
Capital observation, Marie. One should not attempt this procedure unless one has fabricated a temporary mandibular prosthesis.
The diamond is shown being used to produce a depth cut of approximately 1.5 millimeters. More than one depth cut may be used. A periodontal probe or putty reduction guide may be used to verify this. The distal one half of the edge is reduced. The reduction is completed. Hugh, one thing that must be stressed in reduction of the labial surface is the two-play nature of the reduction.
One should reduce the labial in two planes. The first plane is parallel to the long axis of the tooth. This reduction is critical for resistance and retention of the restoration. The second plane is in the incisal one-third and parallel to the external surface of the tooth. The reduction is anatomic. That is, the tooth maintains its basic shape after reduction. The surface is reduced 1 mm to a uniform smooth surface. Depth grooves are placed in the cervical two-thirds of the tooth. The burr is held parallel to the long axis of the tooth. 3 grooves are placed of 0.8 mm to 1 mm in depth. The cervical two-thirds of the labial is reduced, with the flat end of the diamond producing a 1 mm curved shoulder finish line. The burr remains in contact with the wall of the preparation, thus forming the necessary taper. Reduction again is performed on one half the tooth, reduction is assessed, then the reduction is completed.
Reduce the labial as far into the embrasure as possible without abrading the adjacent tooth. A 90-degree shoulder may be used for the ceramometal crown if a porcelain and butt margin is to be used.
After completing reduction of the cervical two-thirds of the labial surface, the incisal one-third is reduced. The burr is oriented parallel to the facial surface. Again, 3 depth grooves are placed. The entire labial surface of the tooth is reduced 1 mm.
Hugh, carry the reduction as far into the embrasure as possible without abrading the tooth.
You raise a crucial point, Marie. All care must be applied to prevent abrasion of the adjacent tooth.
Dr. Diamond, how should one approach the proximal surfaces?
Very carefully, Marie. As you know, significant aesthetic damage must be avoided by carefully accessing the proximal space. Wedges, matrix band, and close observation of the adjacent tooth should be employed. The method I like is to maintain a thin wall of enamel as the burr progresses through the contact. The proximal surface is reduced to remove axial undercuts, establish a shoulder margin, and create a 3-5 degree taper to the incisal. Some authors advocate reducing the lingual prior to the proximal. I think one will achieve adequate results either way, but better results when one's approach is consistent. Really, Marie, I can't say it enough. One should become confident using a dentiform model and practicing this preparation prior to attempting on a patient.
Once again, I am in complete agreement. You know the old adage, measure twice and cut once.
Using a labial approach, the flame-shaped burr is used to access the proximal. When sufficient space has been created, the 6847 type burr, once again held parallel to the long axis of the tooth, is used to form the shoulder and create the necessary taper. It is crucial to avoid over-tapering the preparation. The burr, when used correctly, will establish the shoulder and correct taper of the axial wall. Better results will be obtained using a gentle sweeping motion with light pressure.
Absolutely, doctor. Light pressure with copious water spray should be employed. Worn or damaged diamond burrs should not be used. All sharp line angles should be rounded. Well, that leaves us with reduction of the lingual. Why is lingual reduction so important?
I think very often the lingual is actually a difficult process. Establishing clearance for 1 mm of porcelain, while maintaining a robust cingulum wall, can be a challenge.
What's so important here?
Well, Marie, insufficient reduction will result in a weak restoration, as you know, which is susceptible to fracture under the forces of occlusion. More insidious is the lack of resistance form that results from the absence of a robust cingulum wall. The cingulum wall must provide resistance to the prosthesis to prevent dislodgement toward the facial.
That's quite disturbing, Dr. Stone.
It's something that must be addressed, and may require additional resistance and retention in the preparation if cingulum wall cannot be established.
A scary thought.
Well, aside from that, reduction of the lingual occurs in two phases. Cingulum wall reduction, where the burr is held parallel to the long axis of the tooth and the 6847 type burr is used. One may use depth cuts, but sufficient clearance must be produced to have a 1 mm thick restoration in all excursions. The burr should produce the correct taper to oppose the labial wall taper.
This is a critical component of resistance and retention. The 1 mm shoulder is extended into the proximal surfaces and completely circumscribes the tooth. The second phase of lingual reduction is the preparation of the lingual fossa area. This is done with a football-shaped diamond, the Brasella 6368 type Burr. Depth grooves may be placed with a round burr to assist in the correct reduction. All line angles should be rounded.
Well, that pretty much describes it. Shall we summarize with some important ideas?
Marie, the preparation should be finished with stones or finishing diamonds to present a smooth uniform surface. Reduction guides and bite tabs should be used to check the reduction.
The proximal contact area should allow the passage of a die saw, and the preparation should be inspected for calculus and caries. If the finish line is placed subgingivally, the tissue should be retracted with a cord. The finish line should not violate the biologic width of the tooth attachment. Occasionally crown lengthening is indicated, but attention to the aesthetic consequences is paramount here.
The finish line is smooth and forms a 1 mm wide shoulder completely circumscribing the tooth. The cavo surface margin is approximately 90 degrees, which best supports the porcelain. Axial walls should taper toward the incisal and allow space for 1 mm of porcelain. All line angles are rounded. The incisal reduction is a minimum of 1.5 mm, not to exceed 2 mm.
As usual, a particular caveat must apply here. The dentist must make an informed decision to select the material to be used. We suggest following the specific manufacturer's recommendations for the proper use of these materials.
Right you are, Marie.
This is Dr. Marie Huggy thanking you for joining us today as we describe the tooth preparation for the anterior all-ceramic crown. I'd like especially to thank our special guest, Dr.
Hugh Greenstone.
Oh yes, thank you. We hope you'll join us in our next video production.
Right you are, Marie.